The Holy Rosary Church at the corner of Park and Henry Streets was known as the French Church. Its parishioners were the French planters who lived in town part of the time and some of the merchant class. Its construction was financed almost entirely by the cocoa producers, largely French Creole, and it was a focal point for Catholic worship among the French-speaking community in Trinidad.
The Mass was in Latin, but all the, shall we say, the adjuncts of the Mass were in French, and the priest preached in French, and the hymns were in French. And some of these hymns were composed by the French Creoles, by, for instance, Sylvester Devnish, and they were sung in the church along with the Latin hymns. The French Creoles did influence, to some extent, the building of the churches because they were financing them, and also, to a lesser extent, the liturgy in the church, so that there was a sort of interchange of ideas. The rosary in particular, the choir was largely French Creole and some colored French upper class families. And also the organists and so on would have been French Creole. And of course the altar boys in those days, girls were not to be seen near the sanctuary. But still the women, as we can see in the case of the rosary here, they were really the support of the Catholic Church in Trinidad and the French Church in Trinidad. I think the women played an overpowering role there.
For Lilius Milne, a founding member of the Roman Catholic Living Waters community, the spiritual values learned in a large French Creole family have made a lasting impact on her life and on her religious vocation.
So Lilius, tell us a bit about your own French Creole background.
Well, Mummy, my mother was a granddaughter of Gaston de Gans, who was the seigneur of La Chance in Arima, and grew up in her childhood on Cocoa Estate in Arima and Carony, her early childhood on the banks of the Carony River.
Now, your great-grandfather at La Chance, I think you have some interesting stories of his wonderful New Year's Day parties. Could you tell us about those?
The families would conglomerate on La Chance, all the different branches. Some of them lived on estates in other parts of the island. But they all had to come to La Chance for New Year's. And there was this huge celebration with, you know, you have slaughtered a pig and a cow and or whatnot. And that was the day that the great-grandfather gave the gifts to his grandchildren and his children and so on. And that was a big ceremony where they all went up to him and received their gift. And then received his blessing also, because as pater familia, he bestowed his blessing on his family. And he had a very strong stipulation that no one could ever sit at his table if they weren't at peace with the rest of the family. So if there was any disagreement or feud or anything like that, it had to be settled before they shared in his hospitality.
You currently live in a religious lay community. How are the values that you learned as part of a big extended French Creole family, how have they translated into your current life? How you live now?
Well, I live in community household, and so it's 18 people that we should relate to on a deep level. And I think if I had come from a small nuclear family, it would have been trauma. But it just seemed very natural to be with all this many people.
To be French Creole was, by and large, to be Catholic. In Tortuga, in central Trinidad, a fertile area of cocoa estates, this church served for many years as a center of religious life for the French Creoles of the area. Simon Taylor, a descendant of the Adrien de Verteuil, who donated the stained glass windows for the church, is one of a dedicated group working on its restoration.
I do believe somebody else told me, saying so, that has to be on that side.
The church was built by L'abbé Marie Dupoux, who was a French architect And this is why this building is so beautifully proportioned, and it is a real jewel. It was built in 1879. You can imagine all the planters around were from the French families, the de Verteuil, the d'Abadie, who would come every Sunday in their carriage. And this was the outing of the week, as they would come from very far away. And it was a social event. After Mass, everybody met.
As Simon says, attendance at Sunday Mass was not only a religious observance, it was also a social occasion. Also, for the older generation, it was important to marry within the Catholic faith. Doreen remembers the greeting given to her Anglican boyfriend by her grandfather, Salier.
Well, I will give you a story. My grandfather lived in San Jose Estate, but it was a different house. And it was a big, tall steps going up to the gallery, and he was on the top there. And Harry was coming for the first time to meet him. So Harry was at the bottom of the
Harry,
steps.
Harry, your boyfriend or fiancé.
Well, whatever. He was at the bottom of the steps.
Yeah.
And Grandpa was there. And then he shouted, "Chi è sa? Protestant or Catholic?" Well, Harry gave that joke to everybody his whole life.
Oh, he obviously gave the right answer.
But they didn't care.
They didn't care. He was just joking.
No, he was serious. He wanted to know because Catholic or Protestant was a great thing in those days.
You had to meet that category.
Yes.
To be accepted.
Uh-huh.
And he didn't meet it.
But you see, long ago, you know, how was Catholic and Protestant?
Yes.
That was a big issue.
Right. Yes.
Is the French impact on Catholicism in Trinidad still an issue today? Or is it now so integrated with Catholicism generally as not to be significant?
It's difficult to say as to whether the French influence has really remained with the Catholic Church in Trinidad. The French priests have gone and the French language has disappeared except in Paramin where it's patois. But I suppose the tradition to some extent is still there. The idea that the church forms a sort of community with the French Creoles. I think what has happened is the French Creole outlook has expanded to include the British and the Irish and the German Creoles, so that it has diluted the French content. And nowadays, I don't think people would be aware of what is owed to the French influence from the So we may say it has really disappeared.
French language and culture, patois, carnival, the legacy of Roman Catholicism à la Française, and also French style, for example, in architecture, can be seen all over Port of Spain if you look behind the signs. The filigree ironwork on 19th century buildings echoes the French Quarter in Old New Orleans and is seen in all its extravagant frivolity on a mansion such as this. Built by cocoa planter Lucien Ambard, it was designed by a French architect in an exuberant French Baroque colonial style, with a roofline of towers, pinnacles, dormers, and cupolas and galleries, as cheerful and playful and full of joie de vivre as we nostalgically imagine our French forebears to have been. The Ambards, like so many of the profligate French families who lived well and saved little, went bankrupt, and this house went through many hands until it was purchased by the Rudal family. It is now the home of Dr. Yvonne Mahabir Morgan, who has named it Rumor. Sometimes the best insights into one's own tribe come from those outside it. How does Dr. Morgan view the French Creole community?
You have to be Trinidadian, like yourself, to understand that all the races keep by themselves. It might be their eating habits, their ideas about marriage or not marriage between the races. So you have the Indians with their own particular prejudices, not particularly wanting to mix with white people or having their children married to white people. You have the white people, the French Creoles, not wanting their children to be married, so they wouldn't have necessarily the social intercourse in case the young girls were attracted to the young men. So that you have the Syrians, they took their wives from the Lebanon. You had the Chinese who took their wives from China. So among us, we understood this. There was not any great confusion. Yes, there is prejudice, but somehow, as you say, in this magical, mystical way, we seem to be able to avoid confrontations on a serious measure where we go and kill each other because of our race. Mm-hmm. We may kill each other because we have money or something like that, but it's not because you're white, I'm going to kill you, or you're Indian, I'm going to kill you. We just kill you because we happen to think that you might have money or for some other reason. What is terrifying in Trinidad, of course, is the drug interaction that's coming in here and messing up people's values.
And what would her friend and neighbor, the late Dr. Eric Williams, first Prime Minister of the Republic, have said?
He, of course, was a divorcier, and he would probably perceive French Creoles as being white rather than being French Creole. And I think he himself had some bad experiences because of color, and this rather prejudiced his outlook. I know that he was very friendly with me, and if I would go to parties at his home, he'd say, "Hello, Dr. Mahabir." He never called me by my married name, and turn his back on my husband, who was white. So that he did have, I would think, knowing him, certain prejudices about white people. And I think a lot of people do perceive that white people are something that they're afraid to approach, and the white people themselves don't know how to approach them, especially in these days when they would like to approach people of color, because there has been this barrier that's gone on for so many years, and they've got to sort of interact with each other, as they will do, because now they're going to malls and they're shopping and you know, they're trying to be friendly in churches and all this sort of thing. And I think that, you know, they must learn to live with each other, because Trinidad is such a paradise.